Windows Exploit Protection. It's a feature that a lot of you have asked me to talk about over time, so I figured I would. And if you've never seen it before, this can be found in the Windows Security Settings, specifically under the Settings menu, then Privacy and Security, Windows Security, App and Browser Control, then Exploit Protection Settings. Originally, this was actually a separate app that you had to download called the Enhanced Mitigation Experience Toolkit, EMET. But later, Microsoft ended up actually rolling it just into Windows itself, which is where it remains today, including for Windows 10 and 11. And like the name suggests, it adjusts how Windows runs apps and deals with certain situations to limit the amount of exploits that would actually work even if they exist within an app. Now, in this menu, you're going to see two main tabs. There's the System Settings and the Program Settings tab. In the System Settings, that's where you're going to have the default controls for a lot of the major settings. And as for what these all do, I'll get to that in a second. And then on the Program Settings tab, that's where you would have individual app overrides where you could change some of those settings that we saw before, but specifically for a certain app. So if you wanted to have it different than the default. I will point out that even if it looks empty here in the Program Settings, Windows does add a whole bunch of default rules specific to popular apps, I guess, that will show up if you wait long enough. I don't know why it takes so long to populate them, but if, for example, you use the Export Settings option, which will save the current overrided rules as an XML file, then they should all show up and you can see that there's a whole bunch. Though how many actually show up may depend on which apps you've installed and used. I think it only gets added as you use them. And if you were to look at any of the individual settings, you would basically see that it's pretty much the same as the settings in the System Settings menu. Now, looking back at the defaults in the System Settings menu, you'll notice that the default for all of them is on, except for the force randomization for images, also called mandatory ASLR, which is short for address space layout randomization. And by the way, images here does not mean pictures. That's actually a term that refers to program files or executables that have been loaded into memory, like an exe or a DLL. Now, like I said, I am going to explain what this setting does along with all the others, but if you're wondering whether or not you should just enable it anyway and just have the maximum protection, theoretically you could, but you might run into some issues. For the most part, if you do enable this by default, nothing will change, but you might notice weird random bugs in certain apps down the line. For example, I had it enabled for a very long time, didn't notice anything, until at one point when I was using GitHub Desktop, I found that for some reason it was unable to clone different repositories. It was getting a weird error, and when I Googled it, I found an issue thread where people basically said, yeah, that's because you have mandatory ASLR enabled in Windows Settings, and sure enough, disabling it put it back, or at least adding an exception. So if you do end up enabling it, just be aware that you might get a really nondescript error down the line that has nothing to do with ASLR. It's not like it's gonna say, this error is because you enabled ASLR. It's gonna have nothing to do with it. And then you probably at that point forgot that you even changed the setting, and it will have a hard time figuring out that's the issue. However, that being said, for the most part, it probably won't break too much stuff, actually. I should also point out that actually the settings in this GUI are not actually all the possible rules for the exploit protection. There is a PowerShell command that you can use to get all of them, which is get process mitigation. And then you can also do this to output it to a file because it's going to be very long. And then you can see in here that the output includes the particular process for each thing and then all the rules associated with it. And you'll notice that there's a whole lot more of them, even more than the settings.xml export we saw before, which only, again, has the ones from the GUI. There's way more here than I could ever have time to go over, but there is a Microsoft article where they go over exploit protection references, and they do explain most of what these are if you're curious. So what I can do is just go over the different settings in the GUI, even though for the most part, you probably don't want to change all of them, but maybe you're curious what they do, and maybe you do want to customize some individual programs or settings or something like that. Before I go over those though, something else that you'll want to do is protect yourself from all the other malware strategies out there, which is where today's sponsor comes in, Bitdefender, and their all-in-one security plan, Bitdefender Premium Security. It's more than just some antivirus program, but a complete security suite, including, relevant to this video, its own exploit detection technology in addition to what Windows does. So it can also detect malware that exploits a vulnerability in an otherwise legitimate application, like a zero-day exploit in an app that hasn't been patched yet, or if the app is old and was never patched. It also has advanced threat defense, which can protect against brand new malware by analyzing its behavior, not just relying on signatures, though of course it can detect them that way too. Bitdefender can detect more than just malicious apps though. It can also detect affect malicious scripts, command line commands, process memory, keyloggers, and more. And with features like network threat prevention, it can stop network attacks before they begin by blocking malicious attempts on system vulnerabilities and brute force attacks. With Bitdefender Premium Security, you even get protection for your mobile devices, where it can detect malicious links even when they appear in SMS messages, chat apps, calendar invites, or mobile app URLs. It also has online scam protection through their Scam Copilot AI platform, including features like scam ad detection to block fake or malicious ads, blocking scam websites, and detecting new scam patterns. And right now, you can get a special 90-day extended free trial to Bitdefender Premium Security through the link in the description, so be sure to check out the link down there. And with all that being said, let's continue and take a look at the different Windows exploit protection settings. All right, so starting off, we have Control Flow Guard, or CFG, which has the description, ensures control flow integrity for indirect calls. To understand this one, imagine that you have some program and it has a function built in called return to main menu. And that program happens to have an exploit that a hacker knows about that allows that hacker to replace the memory address that that program thinks that that function is at. And so the hacker then changes that address to point to some other data used by the program that the hacker can control, like text within user preferences, where the hacker then has code that they put with a malicious function. Now, normally, wherever this code is stored is not anything that will be executed. It's just stored as text data. However, the next time the app tries to return to the main menu on this function, it would be pointed to this code and would actually try to execute it. However, what the control flow guard does is steps in and says, whoa, this is not a valid function address that we know about. And so it would block that call and then defeat that exploit. It would probably still break the program, but at least it's not gonna do what the hacker wants. Next up, we have data execution prevention. And this is sort of similar, but subtly different. And this one is described as being prevents code from being run from data-only memory pages. And if you remember, that's kind of what just happened, but there is a difference. In this case, imagine that there's a program that, again, by some exploit, there's a legitimate function that the hacker is able to overwrite. So they don't have to redirect the pointer to the function, they can actually overwrite the function itself. However, just in this specific example, the malicious code function that the hacker replaces it with is actually larger than the original legitimate function. What will then happen is the program will run the function, and since it's a legitimate address, it's not going to be blocked by control flow guard, but it's going to start running the code and just keep going until it hits a return command. But at some point, it will get into sections of memory that were not originally marked as executable as part of that original legitimate function. So in this case, data execution prevention will step in and say, whoa, you just tried to run stuff that is not in what is executable memory blocks, and then block the rest of that function. So in other words, the memory blocks are identified as being allowed to have stuff that can run as code and not allowed. It's kind of like that video you may have seen where there was a Call of Duty player on Xbox who changed his username to Xbox Off. So then when other players would say something like, why is this guy's name Xbox Off? Or they would yell at him, then the Xbox would hear that and think that that's an actual command and run it and turn off their Xbox. It's sort of a similar idea. All right, now we can get to force randomization for images or mandatory ASLR. And like I said, this is not pictures images, it's just executable files loaded into memory. And the description here is force relocation of images not compiled with slash dynamic base. I'll explain what that means in a second. First of all though, what is address randomization in general? Well, remember that example before where the hacker was able to overwrite the legitimate function? In that case, it was blocked by the data execution prevention because it was larger than the original legitimate function. But what if it wasn't? What this does is randomizes the memory addresses of everything at runtime so that the hacker would not actually know where that legitimate function is located ahead of time, which would make it a lot harder to find it and code to overwrite it if they were even able to do it at all. However, the thing is that an app has to actually support this address randomization feature. Otherwise, it could be hard-coded to use specific memory addresses. And what that dynamic base thing that was mentioned before does is basically when you compile the program, you mark it as, yes, this supports randomized addresses. And most modern apps made anytime recently should have that, but older ones might not. But what this setting does, like the name suggests, is it actually forces address randomization for all apps even if it's not marked as supporting it. Now, Windows will still try and do stuff to make it work anyway, but sometimes it still causes issues. And I should point out that you don't need to have this setting to force it on for all other apps to use it. From my understanding, if a app supports it and is marked as supporting it, then it's always going to use it anyway. And this setting is only going to affect apps that are not marked specifically as supported. However, you could argue that hackers are going to be more likely to target any apps that are known to not support it. So you could increase the security by forcing it on. All right, now next up is a pretty similar setting, and this one is called Randomize Memory Allocations, or Bottom-Up ASLR. And this one is described as Randomize Locations for Virtual Memory Allocations. So wait, what's the difference with this one then? Well, in addition to ASLR, which we already talked about, which was actually for randomizing the so-called base address of the app, which is more for the program file itself and its functions, the program may need to and probably does need to also allocate memory for data that it uses at runtime. And normally it assigns this memory starting at the end of its assigned memory space. So this setting simply randomizes that starting point as well for the same reasons. Next up, we have the setting called High Entropy ASLR. And this one is described as increase variability when using randomized memory allocations, also bottom-up ASLR. Basically, this just means that if an app is 64-bit, or it's 64-bit aware, it's gonna have way more possible addresses assigned to it randomly, as opposed to what it would if it was 32-bit, which is only gonna get 4 gigabytes of space. If it's 64-bit, it can be up to hundreds of terabytes. And Windows kind of abstracts that right away, so even if you get assigned an address that's at 100 terabytes, even if you don't have 100 terabytes of RAM, which you probably don't, Windows internally redirects it. So that's what that means. So basically, it just makes it a lot harder if a hacker were to randomly check some address that it would have any chance of finding anything useful. Unless, of course, they knew exactly what to look for, which is possible, but harder. All right, next up, we have the setting Validate Exception Chains, or SEHOP, which stands for Structured Exception Handling Overwrite Protection. And that is described as ensures the integrity of an exception chain during dispatch. Now, an exception is just an error, basically. And if you've ever written code, you know that a lot of programming languages have try-catch blocks, they're called, where if an error or an exception occurs within that try block, then it goes down to the catch block, and then you can literally handle it in there, and it's called handler. And you can usually have different multiple catch blocks that are meant to catch specific exception types, or you could have a general one. Anyway, just like individual functions, these exception handlers or catch blocks have their own pointers or addresses that point to it. And it's possible that because of some exploit, a hacker may be able to trick the program into replacing the pointer or address to one of those catch blocks and then instead point to malicious code. And what this setting does is adds different checks that can determine whether any of the addresses to these different handlers was messed with and block that. All right, now finally, we have the setting Validate Heap Integrity, which has the description, terminates a process when heap corruption is detected. And like I mentioned before, heap is basically memory where it can store different data during runtime. It's actually used for quite a lot of stuff. Now, I'm not knowledgeable enough to really get very deep into this, but apparently there are ways that hackers can, via some exploit, trick the program into messing with the data in the heap or accessing or changing data in there that it's not supposed to at a certain time. So this setting just enforces some ways that it can check whether or not this corruption has actually occurred. So if you were wondering what all these different settings were before, now you know, or maybe you didn't know this whole menu existed at all before. And I'd also be curious if any of you consider yourself experts on some of the other settings that are hidden away with that PowerShell setting. You can talk about that down in the comments. Now, if you enjoyed the video, you know what to do. Absolutely annihilate the like button, nuke it from orbit. It really helps out. Thanks again to Bitdefender for sponsoring, and be sure to check out the 90-day extended free trial of Bitdefender Premium Security through the link in the description. If you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is where I talk about what happens if you don't actually restart after installing an app and it asks you to do so. I'll put that link right there you can click on, and if you want to subscribe, I try to make videos about twice a week, Wednesday and Saturday, so it should be worth it. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.